Satan has got a couple of those angels too. Now, they're black angels, but they're still, not black, excuse me, they're dark, evil angels. So, but they don't go behind you, they don't follow you, they get in front of you. You want to know what their names are? Aggravation and agitation. Aggravation and agitation are always before you. Goodness and mercy is always following you. Agitation and aggravation is before you. Satan tries to set traps for us. Psalms 91 says, I will deliver you from the snare of the fowler. Doesn't say you don't ever have to walk through one or get trapped in one. Amen? Because you can get trapped in aggravation and agitation. Amen? That's the spirit. Those are spirits. I know they jumped on me this morning. Amen? We had worked really hard all week to get this thing back here set up and have everything perfect. And we come in this morning and one of our computers bit the dust. So you won't have words this morning. Wasn't anything the guys did, nothing. It's just the computer decided to die between Friday night, 7 o'clock, and this morning. Amen? And then yesterday, I was going to shred up the Boston butts for and Johnny had built me this big thing that you put in your drill motor and put butts in, and it'll shred them up in just a little while. Well, I decided to drop it on my foot, and it embedded in the top of my foot and put a big hole in there. So that's why I'm wearing flip-flops this morning. Just wanted everybody to know, because I didn't want you to leave home and go, and that'd be the only subject around the lunch table today. Why I was pastoring flip-flops, okay? I got a big hole in my foot. I tried to put a shoe on. It wasn't happening. So anyway, but aggravation and agitation will get in front of you. But here's the thing. If you'll keep walking, goodness and mercy will catch up with aggravation and agitation, and they will kick some booty head. Amen? That's just all the way it is to it. Amen? So thank God that His Word is more powerful than anything Satan can put in front of us. Can I get an amen this morning? Praise God. We need to remember real quick before we start service, we're going to have our normal prayer, but I just feel very challenged this morning to pray specifically. We got so many folks around us that are struggling and fighting, so much stuff going on all around us. But folks, these folks that are in the eye of this thing and coming in Louisiana, many of you were here and remember Ivan and what it did to us and what we walked through. Well, this thing is stronger than that, and it's going to be, unless God does that, it's going to be bad, and we need to pray for these people that are getting ready to face this. Amen? Because this probably folks fixing to lose everything they've ever known or had, not to count life, too. So let's pray this morning and just ask God to have His hand upon that mightily. I had a video I wanted to show you this morning about testimonies and miracles, but, of course, that's probably why the computer bit the dust. Satan didn't want that play. But pray with me and let's remember this. Father, we come to You this morning. First of all, Lord, we are challenged. We are a challenged people, Lord God. And without Your mercy and grace, Lord, we wouldn't even exist anymore, Lord. But because You've been so merciful and so gracious to us, we're here this morning gathered together to worship You in spirit and truth, Lord. You're looking for some, Lord. And I heard this morning, Lord, a preacher saying about a remnant, Lord God, a small remnant. Well, a remnant's already just a little piece of cloth, Lord. And a small remnant, Lord, is even smaller than that, Lord. But God, You told me in Your Word that You took 12 men and turned the world upside down. Your church is still strong. She's still powerful. She's still living. She's still breathing. She's the body of Your Son, Jesus Christ. He has anointed us to be here for such a time as this, Lord God, to share the light, to share the gospel and the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. So, Father, we thank You today for that. Now, God, we ask You, Lord, to watch over those people, Lord, that are in the eye of the storm, Lord God. God, we just ask You, Lord, to spare life, Lord. Do wonders, Lord. Work miracles, Lord. Get glory for Your wonderful name, Lord, out of this situation. As we come to worship You in spirit and truth this morning, Lord, we pray for Your presence and Your presence alone. In Jesus' name I pray, and all God's people said,
amen. Thank You, Lord. Stand and worship with us this morning. I'm going to go to the next slide.
Thank you. Thank you.
God, we love you. Come on, raise your voices and give the hand. Let the shout be given unto God in the voice of triumph in this place this morning. We are the head and not the tail. We overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. And they did not love their lives unto death. Praise God. I don't know about y'all, but I'm blessed already. Y'all ready to go home? We want to release our children now to Children's Church. Amen, guys. Y'all ready to go get blessed? Miss Donna got y'all. Hallelujah. She said she was going to shower y'all with candy this morning. Send you home with your parents. God doesn't know what I'm saying. Get you down to the world. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Hey, I better burn me. That money before you go that way. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. I was going to share a video this morning, and of course, a few bit, but I want to tell you just a little bit about it. When the flooding took place in Tennessee, I know many of you watched that on news, and people lost their lives. I mean, this thing came out of nowhere and just swept people away. Well, there was a 90-year-old man. Anybody see that video of the 90-year-old man? Some of you did. A few of you did. So it's this 90-year-old man, and he's standing there watching houses, mobile homes, just being swept away. Just gone. Just people drowning. And so they went and interviewed him because his was standing. And he had a mobile home sitting there. He was standing there. Kind of good. And they interviewed him. And this is what he said. He said, I'm a believer in Jesus Christ. And for some reason whatsoever, he chose to leave me here. I don't know what he's going to do with my three dogs, but he left them too. But he just gave all the glory to God. And I mean, you could just tell this newscaster was just mesmerized. And she goes, well, I understand you've even written a book on miracles. And he said, yeah, it's on Amazon, and it's called The Hell and Back in a Bottle, which I planned all of it for. He said, because you see, I was an alcoholic. But since October something or other, I will have been sober for 50 years. And he said, I've seen miracle after miracle that my Lord Jesus has done for me in my life. But if we get back next time and get time, the Lord leaves, we'll play it again. But this awesome testimony. You can probably Google it or YouTube it. Tennessee, 90-year-old Tennessee guy shares testimony, but it's pretty powerful. It's really good. Praise God. Anybody besides Miss Jackie want to testify? Anybody? Come on, Miss Jackie. Miss Jackie wants to testify. I mean, I like it when Miss Jackie testifies. Them babies in the nursery miss Miss Jackie. Amen. Wouldn't all of us like just crawl up on her and just go to sleep with her and Miss Jackie hugging us?
Well, I'm a 78-year-old woman, and don't think you can't learn when you're 78 years old. So, and memorizing scriptures is a must. One night I was just unconsolable, and Carlton had been so sick, and I just told the Lord, I said, every day I feel like I'm losing a little bit more of him, and I'd reach over and touch him. So I was just distraught, and I began to pray. I said, Lord, I need some scriptures tonight. And, you know, and a little bit would come, and a little bit would come, and then all of a sudden it just began to pour. Scriptures from Bible school, and you know how long ago that's been. But in Nancy's class with Danny, we memorized scriptures. And I said, Lord, I just need something tonight. I just need you to comfort me tonight, Lord. I just, you know, with Mandy, the situation and everything, and all of a sudden, the scriptures just began to pour into me, and I felt like the Lord was singing the scriptures to me. I have never felt that before in my life. Never. So that's why scripture and memorizing for your own sake, because you don't ever know when you're going to get caught and not know what to do, but when you start with the scriptures, he's going to be there, and that was sweetest time of my life, and I've had many, and I'm an old woman, and I'm still learning, so you can still learn, and you can still minister, okay? All right,
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. That's one of the things that I love so much about our Honor Star system when we have missionettes is the girls that went through that had to memorize and be able to quote 40 verses of Scripture in order to earn their, what did they earn? They didn't earn the dress. We bought the dress. What did they, their thing, yeah. Thank you very much. There you go. That thing. But I love it. And so Elizabeth's been teaching Briley. They take the alphabet. And whatever the letter of the alphabet, Briley quotes a scripture from it. She's too far now. I. She's always I. So she can quote a scripture, A, B, C, D, E, F, with all those. And I think that's pretty cool. So praise God. You can never go wrong memorizing scripture. And we're going to talk about this more than this, because what happens is, remember we've been talking the last 2 weeks, when the Word and the Spirit meet up in faith, something has to be created. It has to. God can't lie. It's going to create or recreate after itself. God said, I watch over my Word to perform it, and it shall never return to me void of power without accomplishing that I set it out to do. Amen? So that's important. A couple announcements real quick before we get started. We're going to have a new member class on October the 10th. We got some folks that want to become members. Amen. Praise God. Isn't that awesome? We love taking in new members. So we're going to have a new convert class October the 10th. And we will get you guys, because that's right before the board meeting, and we'll get y'all approved and get you on the ballot. And praise God. Good stuff. Chicken and rice plates. $7. Sign up. It's in the foyer. September the 12th. That's two Sundays from now. Yes. $7 for a chicken rice plate. And what is it? Is it? Girls' conference. Oh, yeah. We're good. We can't select. We're not going to do front porch tonight. I don't know. It looks like our weather is probably going to get the most of it tomorrow and tomorrow afternoon accordingly. But I just thought, you know, with everything going on and stuff happening and all, you know, that probably maybe celebrating time wasn't appropriate. So with all that's around, maybe you can use that time to pray for all our people that are going through so much. Amen. We've got a lot of stuff going on around us. And if we didn't have the hope of the Lord, it would be overwhelming. It would just be terrible. So, praise God. Anybody else on that thing? Praise the Lord. Well, let's go to the Word of the Lord. If you'll turn with me to 2 Timothy, and you're actually going to have to use the Bible this morning if you follow along or your Bible app on your phone or pad, because we don't have a script. I hadn't had to type out scriptures in a long time, and I had to go to my office and type all my scriptures out this morning. And I was like, wow, that's the way we used to do it in the old days. But anyway, 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. And there's Bibles all up under the chairs of... not to bring one, because I know we get used to looking at it on the screen. That's fine. There's nothing wrong with that, because I know you read your Bibles at home. There was a new pastor had just come to a church. One of the couples in the church invited him to lunch that day. And so he went to lunch, you know, and the husband and wife were cleaning up afterwards, and the wife just got beside herself. She said, I believe that pastor stole one of my soup spoons. And she just wouldn't let it go. She said, I know how many spoons I have, and I'm missing a spoon, and I promise I believe I saw him pick that spoon up. Dude, well, I believe that pastor stole my spoon. Now, I want you to think in that whole year's time how many sermons she probably listened to that he preached. So next year rolled around, they invited him back on the same day, because in the old days, I guess they took turns inviting the pastor every Sunday for lunch. Hint. And no, play a pick. I'm playing. But so the next year, same time, inviting, well, she just couldn't stand it. So she just blurted straight out, asked him, said, Pastor, I just got to know, did you steal one of my spoons last year? He said, no, I didn't. I put it in your Bible. That's a good one right there. I don't care who you are, especially if you're a preacher. Say laying blocks. Anybody ever lay blocks or bricks or anything or seen it done or whatever? I didn't even think about that. That's the second attack on my right foot. Because that block off the back of my getting it for you fell off the back of my golf cart and got that same foot. It was just getting well. It If it messes up my golf game, I'm talking to somebody in my prayer. Laying blocks, the last couple weeks, we've been preaching about the person of the Holy Spirit and getting to know Him, because I believe God spoke to me as clear as a bell and said, in these times we're living in and what's before us, we're going to need to know the Holy Spirit in a personal way so that we know that He's speaking to us, because there's so many, oh my good Lord mercy have on us, there's so many voices everywhere around us. And if we can't learn to shut those voices out and hear the Holy Spirit, then we're going to be listening to people just like us who know very little about anything. But the Holy Spirit is omniscient, which means He knows everything, not some things. He knows everything. So remember, 2 weeks ago, we preached a message entitled, May I Introduce You to the Holy Spirit. And we found out that He was there in Genesis. He shows up in the second verse of the first chapter of Genesis. And He's the incubator. He's the one that makes what, when God speaks His word, the Holy Spirit's the one that nests on that thing until it hatches and becomes real in our life. So when we speak the word in faith, when the Holy Spirit and the word can find a place of faith, then it's something that's always created right there. Mine and your problem is too many times we'll exhibit faith and speak the word in faith. The Holy Spirit shows up, but before He can get it incubated, what have we done? We doubted. And once we doubt, the Bible says it's always go back to and start all over again. And then last week, we talked about His involvement in world affairs. And we know that the deliverance of Israel didn't start at the burning bush, but over 400 years before, with a teenager in a pit. So we see the Holy Spirit, how He orchestrated that whole thing. For 400 years, He orchestrated the deliverance of the nation of Israel. 400 years. And it started with a teenage boy who had done no wrong, just being a little arrogant. And thrown in a pit. That's where that whole thing started, with Joseph. And so we see the Holy Spirit in world affairs. So this morning, we got a couple of foundations. We got the foundation of we believe the Holy Spirit was there with God in the beginning. He's the one that incubated it. He is involved in our everyday life. Not only in our everyday life, but He's also involved in world affairs. So the Bible says God sets up rulers and He takes them down. Who does that? The Holy Spirit. So this morning, we want to start laying some blocks. Because we need to build a house. Because the Bible says that if you and I will build our house on the foundation of Jesus, which is the Word, if you and I build out, no matter what storms come, no matter what winds blow, no matter what rains come, that house will stand because we're built on the solid foundation of Jesus Christ and His Word. But if not, if we don't build our house on that solid rock, then the first little rain that comes along washes all sand away and we go away with it. So let's build some blocks this morning. 2 Timothy 3, 16 and 17. All Scripture, say all, is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine. That means that's the stones, that's the blocks. Doctrine is what you build your faith on. It's what you believe. It's what's so deep down there in your knower that it can't be moved no matter what. It's your doctrine. Profitable doctrine, for reproof, in other words, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. God's word's also supposed to straighten us up. I mean, the wife would grab the tie and pick it up and straighten her husband up, you know? Y'all don't do that, wives? Mine does. Straighten them up. Now watch this. Why did God give His word my inspiration to do all this, that the man of God may be complete, totally mature, thoroughly equipped for every good work. Father, in the name of Jesus, as always, we ask Your anointing upon Your word, God. Help us, Lord. You know that a mere man cannot handle this word, Lord. God, through You, the Holy Spirit inside, Lord, You can take Your word and send it out to every person and have it mean exactly what that person needs in their life today. So, Father, I pray You'll speak. give us ears to hear what the Spirit said to the church. In Jesus' name I pray, and all God's people said. Now, these two are our foundations that we talked about. The Holy Spirit was there in the beginning. He's all-powerful. He's all-knowing. He's all-everywhere present. And we also believe that He is involved in all the affairs of this world. Not just what's going on here, but what's going on all around the world. The Holy Spirit is there and He's involved. The Holy Spirit is in the beginning. The Holy Spirit is involved. So now let's build some doctrine in our lives that can't be moved. Hebrews 6, 1 and 2 says, therefore, leaving the discussion of the elementary principles of Christ. In other words, we've got to get the elementary stuff secured in our hearts before we go anywhere else. That morning I stepped up and walked to that altar and met Jesus Christ for the first time. I didn't have a clue in this world about anything except I was sick and tired of being sick and tired, and I didn't want to die in the state I was in. I didn't know anything. All I knew is when I walked up there, I met Him for the first time. I saw Him hanging on the cross, taking all my sins upon Himself. I saw Him paying the price for me. And I wept and wept and wept at what my sin had done to an innocent man. That's all I knew, because I was free. And I got up off there a changed man. But I didn't know anything about doctrine. Didn't know anything. But let me tell you this. There were two things that were secure in my heart when I got up off that altar. There was nobody in this world that could tell me or prove to me or show me any fact in this world that God wasn't real. From that moment on, I knew that God was real. That was embedded. That was one of my foundations that could not be shaken. No scientist on this earth could show me any proof or anything. Why? Because I was there. The proof is in the pudding. You can't argue with a man who's had an experience. You can argue with a man who's got words in his head, but you can't argue with a man who's had an experience. I know that that thing Johnny built for me, if I drop it on my foot, it's going to hurt. I know that now. Why? Because I've had an experience. You can't tell me different anymore about that. Got the Band-Aid to prove it. Amen. Having left the elementary church of Christ, let us go on to a perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and faith toward God. In other words, you don't do that. Of the doctrines of baptism, laying on the hands, resurrection, dead, eternal judgment. That ought to be apparent. All that stuff, that's just elementary stuff. In other words, the minute we read that, that ought to be evident to us. That's what we need the Holy Spirit for. We need the Holy Spirit for the supernatural stuff. You and I can do the practical stuff, but we got to have the Holy Spirit anoint us to see the supernatural stuff. And every one of us in here know that we need miracles, amen? So let's build some doctrine in our lives that can't be moved. Satan's main attack on mankind has been and always will be on the Word of God. Has God really said? You need to filter everything in your life through those three words right there. Because that's always where Satan's going to come. That's always where he's going to attack you. That's always where he's going to try to get you to doubt the Word of God. If Adam and Eve had just believed the Word of God, we wouldn't be in this fix today, amen? But if you and I were in the place of Adam and Eve, we'd still be in the fix we're in because we'd have done the same thing, amen? How do I know? Because we're still doing it today. Has God really said? Satan is always going to attack the Word of God. Why? Because if he can cause man to doubt the Word of God, then man has no final authority in his life. What do I mean by that? There are no absolutes. There are no absolutes. If God's word is not our final authority, then murder is not against the law. Pedophilia is not against the law. None of this stuff that's against the law. We don't have any basis to govern our lives by if it's not the Word of God. Our whole Constitution is set up on the Word of God. The premise that men have got enough sense to know that murder is wrong. The premise that men's got enough sense to know that, look, if the leaders you got over you are not leading right, vote somebody else in. I read something yesterday that boggled my mind. Never even thought about it. And some guy from Bulgaria or somewhere wrote it. I don't even know where he's from. He's from one. But it was just his observation. And this is what he said. And I'm sorry if this hurts your feelings because I'm not calling any, but this was, I'm just repeating because this pertains to the Word of God too. If you know the Word, and you know it works, and you know it's beneficial and good, but if you don't apply it to your life, you're an idiot. So this guy from some other country says, look, I look at y'all and I don't understand the United States of America. You got everything every other country in the world wants. And he said, I don't have Biden being president, that don't move me. That don't bother me. He said, because you can get, you buy a bag of apples. And 20 of them be good and one of them be, what I'm saying. So, but he said, what bothers me, or what concerns me, is there's enough people in this country who have lost their moral compass in order to put someone like that in office. And that's what he said. Now, this is from a person who doesn't have anything to do with us. He's standing off in another country looking at this thing. And he says, all I see is decay, is the slide. Well, what about in our spiritual lives? And I don't care about politics. I ain't worried about that because God's going to take care of that. But if we got so many people in our nation, Keith, that have drifted from the truth of God's Word, even before I got saved, even when I was a heathen, I knew better than to do certain things. That there was consequence if I did them. You know what I'm saying? And the church was off limits, period. You didn't fool with nothing. You didn't cut donuts in the churchyard. You go cut them in somebody's cotton field or cornfield or something, or run through a barbed wire fence. But you didn't fool with the church. You know what I'm saying? It's so our moral compass has slid so far. Why? Because the Holy Spirit has been asked to move over here. Let us have this thing. We'll run it. We know better than you. We're smarter than you, God. And that's where we are. Not only, but see, the nation, the politics and everything else of the nation reflects the church. As the church goes, so the nation goes. As the church goes, so the nation goes. And we got to take some responsibility because we lost our zeal. We quit remembering, hey, this thing is about winning souls, man. This thing is about impacting our community. This thing is about loving our neighbor, not worrying about where they got a tattoo or earring or something, but worrying about where they're going to spend eternity at. Not worrying about if they got a stinking vaccination card or wearing a mask. Where are they going to spend eternity? That's got to be our worry. And if we'll go back to doing that, God will take care of the other stuff. What was that? What scriptures are on? Oh, Hebrews. Thank you, Lord. So when we start laying our box, the first one, we must be in complete and total faith in God's Word and how it came to us. So turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. We're going to go through some scriptures there. Now, the Bible did not come by scientific investigation. They didn't take something out of the atmosphere and put it under a microscope and say, here's where the Bible comes from. No. It didn't come by human reasoning. It came by revelation. Revelation is the transmission of truth from the heart of God to man. What do we mean by that? The vehicle of revelation is the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians 2, 9 and 10. But as it is written, I have not seen nor ear heard. See, I always thought this scripture was talking about heaven. Didn't you? Have you heard this scripture preached 100 times in your life? And always thought it about heaven, didn't you? Eyes not seen, nor his ears heard, nor has entered to the heart of man those things God has prepared for those that love him. I always thought it was talking about heaven. It ain't got nothing to do with heaven. I didn't know that until right now. But listen, I'll prove it to you. Watch this. I have not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him. Watch this. But God has revealed them to us through his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yes, the deep things of God. What is he talking about there? The Holy Spirit's the only one who knows the mind of God. He's the only one who knows the thoughts of God. He goes and gets the thoughts of God and comes and declares them to us. This thing doesn't have anything to do with heaven. Never saw it before. Been studying this word 30 years. Never dawned on me. He's not talking about heaven. We got a whole book of Revelation that tells about heaven. We got other things. Jesus talked about heaven. But right here, he's talking about the Holy Spirit knowing the mind, knowing the thought of God, and coming and bringing it to us. Eye has not seen. No, an unredeemed person hadn't seen. Ear has not heard. No, an unredeemed ear hasn't heard. That's why it's no sense wasting time trying to have an argument or discussion with somebody's dream. You speak a language different than theirs. It's like us trying to speak English and somebody else speaking Japanese and trying to carry on a conversation that doesn't work. The redeemed. No, their eye has not seen, nor has their ear heard, nor has entered into their heart. But when the Holy Spirit comes and begins to draw a man to God, then the Holy Spirit begins to tell us, wait a minute, you are worthy to be saved. Jesus came and died for you. And if you'll repent and turn and follow him, your name will be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And that's what he's talking about in these scriptures right here. The Holy Spirit. He does it all. But God has revealed them to us through his Spirit. Praise God. The Bible didn't come by scientific investigation. It came by revelation. And the vehicle of that revelation is the Holy Spirit. Only God's Spirit knows the thoughts of God. So he is the one who reveals what I can't see and nor ear can hear. Reveal means to uncover. The Holy Spirit uncovers God to you and I to help us see him. The Holy Spirit, who only knows the thoughts of God, breathed through the inspiration, the men of God, who wrote down God's thoughts. 2 Peter 1, 20 and 21. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of Scripture is of any private interpretation. For prophecy never came by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. Now watch this. I'll give you an illustration. Say, God help me.
God help me.
What came out of your mouth same time the word did? Okay. Huh? Breath. You can't try to say a word out of your mouth without breath going with it. You can't do it. Interpretations in here. There are no contradictions. There are no anything else. God is big enough. If God spoke and said, let there be light, and immediately his breath went with his word, and there was light, then God can get his book right that he left with us. We got to understand some of these things. I'm talking about foundations, y'all. I'm talking about building blocks. I'm talking about things that are so sealed inside of you that no matter what anybody says or does or show you, it doesn't make any difference. It's there. My house is built on that. I know without a shadow of a doubt God's word is true. It's true. It came from God. It was revealed unto man. Man wrote it down by the inspiration of God. That's the building block in my new life. Hallelujah. 2 Peter. Knowing this first, no prophecy came from any private person. Moved by the Spirit is a picture of a sailboat being moved by the wind. Anybody ever watched the movie where all the sailors were doing good as long as they had wind in the sails, and they was rocking along, and all of a sudden they'd go days without any wind, and they didn't go anywhere. They didn't move anywhere. They didn't go anywhere. This was one of the things that caused me to seek the baptism in the Holy Ghost. When as a Christian, I realized that I was here, but I wasn't doing a whole lot for the kingdom. And I don't know how y'all feel about, but I owe God so much that I want to do everything I could to try to pay back some. Everybody in here wasn't forgiven as much as I was, it's obvious. I'm like Paul. I was the chief among them. And to whom much is forgiven, that one loveth much. So I just want, and so one day I realized, hey, wait a minute. God wants to put some wind in my sails. God wants to send his Spirit not only to be with me, but to be in me and empower me to go wherever he blows. Now, I used to determine my direction and wherever I went, and usually that direction took me to places I didn't need to go. So I needed the Holy Spirit to guide me through everything I do now. I'm telling you, I'm just being honest with you. I make that right there so mad sometimes she can spit. And she don't spit much. Because she'll ask me to do something, and I just, it's one of those things. But then, you know, later on, the Holy Spirit tells me to do it, and I go do it. She wants know why I didn't do it 2 weeks ago when she told me to. And my answer is always the same, because you ain't the Holy Spirit. If we are so in tune with the Holy Spirit, so led by Him, then it won't matter what anybody else around us is doing. It won't matter if somebody hurts your feelings. It won't matter what goes on, because He's going to take from Jesus and declare it to you. And Jesus said, hey, I don't care. You love them anyway. I don't care. You bless them anyway. I don't care. You give anyway. What if I treated you like you want to treat them? Well, hello! Tongue tied right there. Make talking tongues right there, won't it? The Holy Spirit was all up in creation. He's all up in world affairs. He brought God's thoughts to man to record in a book we call the Bible so we can communicate with God. But not only that, He makes sure we can understand God's Word. Then when we place our faith in that Word, Romans 10:17 says, but faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Amen? So when we place that faith, then we can confess Romans 10:9-10, the word is near thee, even in thy mouth, that if you will confess Jesus Christ as Lord and believe in your heart God raised Him from the dead, you shall be saved. For with the heart man believeth, and with the mouth he maketh confession. Amen? And we can be saved. We can be born again, and we can be joined again to God, because we were separated from God through our sin. Then John 14:23 tells us that, I must have been lost page here. Hold on a second. I can't find the scriptures. Did I not go in there and write them all down? I guess I didn't write them all down. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, listen to what He said. The Holy Spirit, the Helper, whom the Father will send in my name, He will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. However, when He, the Spirit of truth, has come, He will guide you in all truth, for He will not speak on His own authority, but whatever He hears, He will speak, and He will tell you things to come. What does that mean? That means that you and I can be omniscient also. In our life. Now, He may not tell us what's going to happen in China tomorrow, but He can tell us what's going to happen in our world. I'm convinced with every fiber of my being, Jesus didn't have access to anything on this earth you and I don't have access to. When He walked as a man, clothed as a man, He didn't have anything extra to go with Him that you and I don't have access to. But He stayed so close with the Father. He stayed so in tune with the Father. I believe when He was up on that mountain praying one night, the Holy Spirit said, hey, Daddy said you're going to run across this tomb tomorrow, and Lazarus is going to be up in there, and you're going to need to bring him out there so you can show everybody how powerful God is. Hey, by the way, let me know, tomorrow you're going to be preaching, and these cats going to be done went without. They've been fasting for 2 or 3 days. Not on purpose, just ain't no food. I'm going to need you to feed them. I am convinced that He knew ahead of time what, because I don't know about y'all. I really don't know about y'all. But if I'm up in here preaching on Sunday morning, and all of a sudden I get put on the spot, you know what I'm saying? Like right now, right here, you got to feed them. I don't know about y'all, but I'd be in panic mode. I'd be looking for me an exit somewhere. I ain't got enough food to feed all y'all hungry Sunday. I mean, I ain't got enough money to feed all y'all hungry Sunday. But can you see what I'm saying? Does it make sense? Wouldn't you and I, if we were put on the spot, if we're sitting there trying to console Martha and Mary and everything, and then all of a sudden God says, I want you to raise you. What? Wait a minute now. But Jesus never got caught unaware. He never got caught unaware of what was going on. He was always ready. Watch this. Go call your husband. Well, I don't have one. You're right. You've had five. And the one you're with now is not your husband. He was always ready. And all He wanted to do was restore one woman who was with Him. Who knows what got her to that place? Because He knew He was fixing it the whole time. He knew ahead of time. Why? Because He lived in such close relationship with the Holy Spirit. He didn't grieve the Holy Spirit. He didn't quench the Holy Spirit. He lived. He knew. However, the effects of the Holy Spirit and the Word meeting up with faith is a renewed, regenerated mind. Titus tells us, and I know it did that one because where are you at, Titus? Titus chapter 3, verse 3 and 5. Not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. You'll say amen, I say. Thank God it didn't take my works to get me saved. Amen? Through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior, the living word. Then it becomes bread when you are hungry. Matthew 4:4. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Praise God. It's milk to wash the bread down with. 1 Peter 2:1-2. Therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking, as newborn babes, desire the pure milk of the word that you may grow thereby. So not only does the word become the bread for our lives, but God gives us milk too to wash it down with, baby. I like that right there. That's good stuff. Good stuff. And not only is it bread and milk, but it's health and healing. Psalms 107:19-21. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them out of their distresses. He sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destruction. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. What did he send to heal us? His word. Word and spirit. Meeting up with faith. Word and spirit. Meeting up with faith. And then Jesus came as the Word. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word is God. Nothing was made that was not made by him, for him, and through him. He is the express image of the living God. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory as of the only begotten Son of God. And remember, when the Spirit came and lit upon Jesus and remained there. So then you had the Word, the living Word, and you had the Spirit. And everywhere that Word and the Spirit went, there was faith there. And everywhere they went, they raised dead people. They fed hungry folks. They parted. They walked on water. Everywhere. Why? Because when the Word and the Spirit meet up in faith, always something is going to be created. Always. It's got to happen. If it doesn't happen one time, then God's a liar. If it doesn't happen one time in your life, God's a liar. It'll work every single time when you put the Word and the Spirit together and you do it in faith. You get those three ingredients, and every single time something's going to be created. There's nowhere in the Word where you can show me that it didn't happen that way. And last but not least, it's our victory over Satan. Ephesians 6:16 says, above all, taking the shield of faith with which we are able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. I've got a defense mechanism. It don't matter what you throw my way. Ding. 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 Anybody ever seen the movie 300? You need to watch it. It's one of the greatest movies of all time. Some men, 300 men, went up against a million man army. 300 men. 300 men. Against a million. Million. 300 God-fearing men who believed in country and family and the good things in life, who were more than went up against a million of a bunch of heathen, evil, dark sorcerers. And one of the parts of that movie I love, they shot, I don't know how many thousands of them shot arrows, but they just rained, sky went black, and they all just held the shields up, and all those arrows hitting the shield, and then they took the sword and went, let's do it again. And every time I see that, I'm reminded about mine and your shield of faith. That every time I put up that shield of faith, it doesn't matter what Satan throws my way. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if it's the unexpected death of a loved one. It doesn't matter if a child I've raised and loved decides to go in the left field. It doesn't matter, because I've got word to conquer every bit of those things. I got promises from God that if I'll speak them and add faith to them, and the Holy Spirit is there to incubate it and make it come to pass, then I know that I will see the goodness of God in the land of the living. couple people like it anyway, Lord. Now, I want you to see this. This is the most important statement I'll make all morning. I'm getting ready to close. So we're going to be early. We can get the large family table at the Hibachi Grill. What's this? Jesus did not enter the wilderness to face Satan until the Holy Spirit alit upon him and remained there. If you don't think the Holy Spirit is the most important asset we have in our lives on the earth today, then we're fooling ourselves. The Son of God Himself, the Word made flesh, the darling of heaven, who has always been and always will be, who is King of kings and Lord of lords, He would not go out into that wilderness and face Satan until He had been anointed by the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit has been misrepresented and polluted and made to look like everything in the world except who He is God. The Holy Spirit is God, the Holy Spirit. He is the thoughts and mind of Almighty God who comes down here to meet up with the word spoken in faith out of our mouth so that He can create that world or nirvana for you and I. And we can be like Bubba Boy. Seriously. We can be like, I'm not saying it's not happening all around us. I'm not saying it's not. I'm talking about, but we can. 1,000 over there. 10,000 over here. Ain't coming near me. Ain't coming near me. And I'm not saying that God, that we don't have to walk through some trials, tribulations, trouble, because that's how God trains us most of the time, or allows us to be trained, if you will. I'm not talking about being insulated from any kind of pain and stuff. I'm talking about He cannot do anything to you that God hadn't already ordained. Read you this last scripture, and I'll read you. But if it was so important to Jesus before He's walked out into that world to face the devil, that He'd be anointed by the Holy Spirit. Wouldn't you suffice it to say that it's pretty important for you and I? Satan was defeated and sent packing when the Word and the Spirit met together with faith. But watch this. Watch this. Look up here at me. Everybody look at me. The living Word must have a dwelling place. Listen to me now. The Word has to have a home. The Spirit has to have a dwelling place. They can't just come and float around. They got to have a place to live. Just like the demons, they can't just float around. They have to have someone. In the spiritual world, they have to have a body on this earth to live in. The Word has to have a body. The Spirit has to have a body. God's question to you this morning, can they have you? Can they have you? That's what God's doing. Every time He knocks on people's hearts, every time He thumps on people's hearts, what He's wanting to know is, can I have you? Can I have you? Can I use you? You said I was your Lord and Savior. That means that I can have you. And you'll do whatever I ask you. You'll do what I need you to do first before you do anything else. Can I have you like that? Can I use you in any manner I want to? Even if it might make you look like a fool, even if it may cost you something, even if it gets you chunked in a pit, can I have you? Because if I can have you, then the Word and the Spirit dwelling in it is going to create stuff all around you everywhere you go. And folks are going to get saved. Folks are going to get healed. Folks are going to get delivered. Folks are going to get set free. Folks going to get peace and joy just from being around you. Why? Because of what's dwelling inside you. Isn't that awesome? So God says, can He have you? Give God some praise for His Word, will you? Will you bow your head and pray with me this morning? Father, in the name of Jesus, oh God, Holy Spirit, I want to ask you right now, forgive me. Forgive me for the times that I've grieved you. Forgive me for the times that I've quenched you. Just forgive me. Father, I'm asking you in the name of Jesus to please forgive me, Lord. I never knew until I started this study, Lord, just how important this is, Lord. And it's no wonder that we walk through some things that we would never have to walk. It was not your will for us to walk through some of the things that we walked through. It was our own choices because we refused to listen. Holy Spirit, we were so much like Adam and Eve, listening to the devil. Has God really said, yes, you did really say whatever's in that book, you said it because you inspired me in that. God, let us get these foundational blocks, Lord, set in our minds and our spirits and our hearts. Let us build our house brick by brick by the promises of Almighty God, by the truth, Lord. And the truth is here this morning that if you're lost, if you're not saved, Jesus Christ came to save sinners. He came to this earth to save sinners. And he said, all we have to do is believe. The thief on this cross said, Lord. If the minute he said, Lord, he was saved right there. When he confessed Jesus as Lord, he said, Lord, remember me when you come in your kingdom. And Jesus said, hey, Lord, today you will be with me. Because he knew what was in his heart. It's not about what we show people or what we say. It's about what we believe in our heart. And the Bible says if you'll confess Jesus as Lord and believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. And if you're out there this morning and you're hurting and you're disillusioned and you don't understand why Aunt so-and-so passed away and you don't understand why my child is this and you don't understand why the husband left and you don't understand those things, I can tell you real quick how to understand it. We live in a fallen world. We live in a world dominated by sin, controlled by the prince of the airways, who is Satan himself. But my word tells me greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And if you'll get him inside of you, you can walk in victory over no matter what comes your way. And if you're in this room this morning, you'd say, Pastor, man, just listening to God preach this morning, just it's a passion, it's stirring a passion. And I haven't had the passion I've needed to serve God faithfully, but I feel the Holy Spirit turning inside of me. Pray that it won't stop. If that's you, would you just slip your hand up and write that down? Pray for me, please. Thank you for your honesty. Father, I pray for passion. Passion in your house again. Passion in your body, Lord. For God, just because we got a disease, a pestilence from hell running rampant among us, you never told us that we could go on vacation from the gospel work, Lord. This gospel shall be preached to the ends of the earth. That's what you said. Jesus told us in all four Gospels when he left parting instructions what we're to be about. Making disciples. Laying hands on the sick. Letting no harm come to us. Preaching the gospel. God, let passion arise in the hearts of your people, Lord God. For we got a world that's still out there that still needs to know that Jesus is Lord. Holy Spirit, come and flood us. Get us ready for a baptism in fire and wind again, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray, and all God's people say, amen. Thank you, guys.
Well, God, we thank you this morning for your word. We thank you for your presence. Holy Spirit, we just ask, dwell inside of us, use us, lead us, teach us, Lord. God, I pray that we see that the Holy Spirit is not an option, that he's a necessity in our life, Lord God. He's that, what I tell the youth is, he's that cheat code, Lord God, that, Lord, if we're going to do everything that you put us on this earth to do, Lord God, we need the Holy Spirit in operation in our life, Lord. So, God, I pray that every person in this room, Lord, feels your presence and feels the tugging on their hearts and know that we need the Holy Spirit in operation in our life to have that fundamental truth, Lord, as Pastor was talking about, those building blocks in our life. It starts with him, Lord. So, God, I pray that every heart receives that here this morning, Lord. And if one doesn't know you, Lord God, that they will not leave without knowing you as their Lord and Savior. Lord, we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.